Good evening.
Forming consensus.
I'd like to go ahead and take your seat. We're going to go ahead and get started.
No. Won't happen. Can't happen.
I'm Matthew Spaulding, Associate Vice President and Dean for Hillsdale College here in Washington, D.C. This is our outpost on the East Coast. Welcome. Today, we celebrate the latest publication, Claremont Review of Books, a fantastic publication and a huge topic, a terrific panel. But all in seriousness, the Claremont Review, wonderful publication, the most important publication in the conservative movement, reviewing books. And I'm very happy to have you here and your moderator this evening, which I need to turn it over to Michael Pack, the president of the firm.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, everyone, for coming. I'm just going to say a few words about Claremont, and then we're going to try to get quickly to the panel. The mission of the Claremont Institute is to restore the principles of the American founding to their rightful and preeminent authority in our national life. Clearly, we have a lot of work to do. We have three main programs. We have these wonderful fellowship programs, 1 or 2 weeks out in California that's about to start every summer, where we teach the history of American political thought to young people. And we have some graduates of our fellowship program, including some panelists, Wendy Long, Charles Kessler, Max Spaulding, to name three illustrious ones, and others in the audience. And we have opened the DC office in part to continue to have programs for our graduates of our fellowship programs. We have a constitutional center, the Center for Constitutional Jurisprudence, which intends to bring courts back to constitutional limits. And we have the Claremont Review of Books, already mentioned by Matt, a great quarterly publication and a website that has more frequent in between the quarterly publications articles. There are copies outside. I invite you all to take a copy and to log on to our website. So we are pleased to host this panel. We have just opened the DC office, and as I mentioned, and one other purpose we have is to have some public programs, and we are hoping to have lively and intelligent discussion of Donald Trump and his movement, and we have a wide array of views, and I'm hoping for a lively and civil conversation. My own job, I think, is just to keep the conversation flowing rather than to advocate a point of view. So I'm going to start with short opening comments by three people who have written articles on this issue of the Claremont Review Books. I'll read their brief bios in the order in which they speak. And then I will come back and introduce our respondents. First is Charles Kessler. He's a senior fellow of the Claremont Institute and editor of the Claremont Review Books, the most recent issue of which features his insights on Trump and the conservative cause. Charles is also the Dengler Dekema, is that how you say it, Charles? Dykema, Distinguished Professor of Government at Claremont McKenna College. And I'm very big on getting names of funders right. I think they are very important. So I work on that for the next time. He has written extensively on American constitutionalism and political thought, and his edition of the Federalist Papers is the best-selling edition in the country. Martha Bayless, on his left, is a film and TV critic for the Claremont Review of Books, and most recently musing on trends in commercial television and how they ushered in Trump's rise. She's also a fellow in the Hudson Institute, an associate professor of the practice of the humanities at Boston College. She is the author of Through a Screen Darkly, Popular Culture, Public Diplomacy, and America's Image Abroad, and Hole in Our Soul, The Loss of Beauty and Meaning in American Popular Music. To her left is Bill Vogley. He is the senior editor of and frequent contributor to the Claremont Review of Books, with their spring issue which features not one but two articles by Bill. One is entitled The Subway to Nowhere, which chronicles the perils of DC's troubled metro system, which I think all of us in this town know well, and what's at stake, a forward-looking assessment of the 2016 election. Bill is also the author of Never Enough, America's Limitless Welfare State, and a visiting scholar at Claremont McKenna College's Henry Salvatore Center. So I'll ask you to speak very briefly, make brief opening statements in that order.
Charles. All right, thank you, Michael. Well, to Trump or not to Trump, that's the question. It's a question for conservatives, it's a question for conservative intellectuals. But prior to answering that intensely practical question, there's a more theoretical one. What is Trump? Or rather, how should we think about Trump? And that's really the question that the Claremont Review tries to answer in its current issue. We're not directly advising anyone how to vote. We are thinking about the Trump phenomenon. But here, let me just summarize my own thoughts about the leading criticisms of Trump that have been made, well made, here inside the Beltway and, of course, outside the Beltway as well. It seems to me that the critics of Trump have two main arguments. The first is that Trump is a buffoon, a clown, an overactive third grader off his Ritalin, a greedy egomaniac whose policies are no better than barroom eruptions, and who by temperament and experience is unworthy to be president. The second argument is that Trump is a monster, a racist, a wily demagogue, a proto-fascist or a full-fledged fascist, a tyrant in waiting. This, Robert Kagan, for example, in the pages of the Washington Post, wrote the following: "This is how fascism comes to America. Not with jackboots and salutes, but with a television huckster tapping into popular resentments and insecurities, and with an entire national political party out of ambition or blind party loyalty or simply out of fear, falling into line behind him," unquote. Or, as Andrew Sullivan put it in New York magazine, quote, "In terms of our liberal democracy and constitutional order, Trump is an extinction level event," unquote. Now, these two arguments are in some tension, insofar as the first implies that Trump doesn't know what he's doing or isn't really serious about it, whereas the second implies that he knows precisely what he is doing and is deadly serious about it. Let me comment here just on the second argument, which I think is in many ways the more distinctive and perhaps the more powerful argument. I find it largely unpersuasive. I don't see many similarities between Mein Kampf and the Art of the Deal. Trump would be one of the first Hitlers to have an Orthodox Jewish daughter, son-in-law, and grandchildren. Above all, where is his party, which is essential, I think, to all fascisms, with its secret or higher wisdom? Where is the socialism in his National Socialism? Where is the glorification, for that matter, of the nation as a collectivity? Now, Trump does admire toughness in a sort of boxer's way, and seems to think that seriousness and goodness grow out of toughness, which is a mistake, I think. The focus on toughness leads to the focus on winning, and these are two of the terms he uses most often. Hence his admiration, and I certainly admit it because it's there, for Vladimir Putin, who does not, I think, but I don't think that admiration implies a desire to emulate Putin's methods or his aversion to democracy. Here, Trump's populism, or what Walter Russell Mead calls his Jacksonianism, comes to bear and rescues him from that, at least, unfortunate implication of the worship of toughness. Trump thinks we are governed by idiots, not by Jews, or traitors. These otherwise intelligent people, like Mrs. Clinton, like Obama, have been turned into idiots, nasty ones, another one of his favorite words, nasty, by a steady diet of political correctness. Not of liberalism, which is a word like conservatism that he rarely uses. If he promises anything, it is to put an end to the reign of political correctness. But is a tough president still a constitutional one? Here is where I think the critic's second argument becomes at least relevant. Trump says very little about the Constitution or the founding, so it's hard to tell what his opinion is. But as the essential or supra-constitutional quality, toughness, comes very close to Woodrow Wilson's personal firmness, or to Teddy Roosevelt's celebration of the active virtues of the man in the arena. It comes closer, that is, to liberalism's century-old effort to liberate executive power from constitutional constraints, and especially the separation of powers. If Trump poses a threat to the Constitution, he is a Johnny-come-lately. It's nice that Andrew Sullivan has returned to his graduate school notes on Plato, and that David Frum as well acknowledges the fragility of American democracy. But isn't it a little implausible to identify the singular threat to constitutional norms with Trump and to conclude that a vote for Hillary Clinton is a vote for constitutional integrity? Trump is worrisome, of course, but it's not because he is an incipient Caesar or Hitler. It's because he's an amateur with no experience in elected or high civil or military office, and because he has played the Donald for so long that one wonders if he can be the president. The critic's first argument thus seems to me the stronger one. I do think, however, that in addition to the very lively and comprehensive catalog of Trump's vices and sins that the press has assembled, there is something that could be said for a couple of his virtues, but I don't have time for that.
I'll respond to you later. I just would like to, I guess my talk sort of has a title, Good for the Media, Bad for America. Speaking to a group of media investors in February, Leslie Moonves, CEO and president of CBS, had this to say about Donald Trump's candidacy. Quote, it may not be good for America, but it's damn good for CBS. The money's rolling in, and this is going to be a very good year for us. Sorry, it's a terrible thing to say, but bring it on, Donald. Calling the campaign a, quote, circus full of bomb throwing, the executive expressed hope that it would not stop anytime soon. A more suitable emotion would be dread. There's always been a circus-like aspect to American presidential campaigns, and for much of our history, we have tolerated, even celebrated this aspect as evidence of our thriving democracy. But alongside the circus, we've always had access to serious reporting about the candidates' clashing policy views, governing philosophies, and qualities of character. This reporting hasn't always been objective, far from it, but until recently it's been lively and accessible enough to reach both the few, meaning people who read elite newspapers and magazines, and the many, meaning people who get their news from radio and TV. None of these media got rich from political reporting, but the newspapers and magazines provided it because they always had, and radio and TV stations provided it because if they didn't, they would lose their licenses from the FCC. All that has changed. In today's mix of deregulated radio and TV, not to mention the never-regulated internet, there are countless sources of political news for those who are willing and able to seek it out. For the majority, though, there's only the circus. And the circus is getting nastier by the day, not to mention more disrespectful of the truth. This poses a serious threat to democracy, both at home and abroad. Right now, the threat is embodied in Trump, but unfortunately, it is bigger than Trump, and it will not disappear if he is defeated in November. The threat is rarely discussed in the media. Indeed, for all their righteous chatter about political correctness, pro and con, the professional motor mouths, I can hear myself. Should I start over? I apologize for that. I'll try not to pop my peas. Okay. The fact that the many who get their news from the broadcast media are getting mostly a circus now is a threat to democracy, in my opinion. And I think it's a bigger threat than Trump, and I think it will outlast his candidacy and outlast this election, unfortunately. The media do not discuss this threat. Indeed, for all their righteous chatter about political correctness, pro and con, the professional motor mouths on talk radio and cable TV almost never mention the shocking debasement of American political reporting. And why should they? Debasement sells, and not just to CBS. Since January of this year, Fox's primetime rating has gone up 30%, CNN's 130%, MSNBC's 68%. In March, a firm called MediaQuant tracked the amount of money spent by the candidates on radio TV ads as opposed to the amount that they receive in, quote, unpaid media exposure. I can run through the figures. It's all in the low hundreds of millions, if that, until you get to Donald Trump, whose figures were 10 million paid and 1.9 billion unpaid. Now, unpaid is, of course, a misnomer. Trump's massive media exposure is paid for lavishly by advertisers. And the advertisers know what they're doing. The primetime audience for cable TV may not be huge. For Fox, it's 2.2 million, CNN, 1.3 million, and you'll probably be glad to hear for MSNBC, only 885,000. But that's television viewership. Thanks to the internet and social media, the actual exposure is exponentially greater. Ever since the election of 2008, experts have been expecting social media to replace radio and TV as the main source of political news for most Americans. But instead, what is happening is an unholy alliance between the old broadcast media, the cable TV, the radio, and the social media, by which every insult, gaffe, and shoving match goes viral 24/7 and stays viral. Together, these media have done what neither could do alone, which is wrest control of the nomination process away from the political parties. And the result is a race to the bottom, in which the prize goes not to the most qualified candidate or even the best debater, but to the biggest grabber of eyeballs. And we all know who that is. And I will finish up. This debasement of our political reporting has a red state explanation, liberal bias carried to extremes, and a blue state explanation, corporate greed gone wild. In fact, there's plenty of blame to go around. In the last half century, the libertarian right and the liberationist left have conspired to remove every constraint on American media, from licensing and ownership to content. And they have done so in a spirit that can only be described as utopian. Wearing their rose-colored glasses, both sides predicted that unfettered media would bring greater competition, greater diversity, greater excellence overall. A more accurate prediction would have echoed Charles Dickens: the best of times for the few and the worst of times for the many. Thanks.
Mic check, mic check. Everyone hears me? Good. One of the many reasons I'm happy Peter Wehner could join us tonight is that I can connect some themes from my most recent CRB article to something he wrote last week, a New York Times essay titled "The Indelible Stain of Donald Trump." Pete argues that Trump is waging an open attack on the three conservative principles that have defined the Republican Party since Ronald Reagan's presidency: a commitment to limited government and economic freedom, moral traditionalism, and a belief that a confident, engaged America can be a force for good in the world. Trumpism and conservatism are, in Wehner's view, antithetical and irreconcilable, so he urges Republicans to run from and against Trump rather than with him. To which I say, the Trump phenomenon is better understood as revealing rather than causing disaffection among Republican voters for the conservative project
and deep skepticism about the coherence and practicality of conservative principles. Take the question of limited government. In the 22 years since the 1994 midterm elections, Republicans have controlled both houses of Congress for a majority of the time. 6 years during Bill Clinton's presidency, more than four during George W. Bush's, and now the final 2 years under President Obama. Yet, never once during the 12 years it held sway over the congressional budget and appropriations processes did the party of limited government ever get around to zeroing out the National Endowment for the Arts, or the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, or any of dozens of other government programs and agencies that conservatives denounced in 1994 and denounce today. It took a rude individual like Donald Trump to highlight the awkward fact that Republican politicians invoke the sacred conservative principle of limited government when they're trolling for votes and donations, and then discard it immediately when they're back in Washington, engaged in grown-up work in serious governance. Trump's apostasy consisted of asking the voters, if the conservative high priests don't take limited government seriously, why should you? It's a good question, and Trump won. Whatever you think of Donald Trump, and whatever happens between now and Election Day, it would be a grave mistake, I believe, for conservatives to make it their mission to reconstitute conservatism after 2016 exactly as it existed before, as if the Trump phenomenon had been a non-occurrence. Rather, an intellectually and politically viable conservatism must address the questions he raised and the deep dissatisfactions his political success has revealed.
Thank you all. Those were great talks. Our first respondent, I'll give her a bio and ask a question, although you may feel free, Wendy, to deviate from the question. First respondent is Wendy Stone Long. She is the U.S. Senate nominee of the New York Republican, Conservative, and Reform parties to oppose Chuck Schumer. An attorney by trade, Wendy was a litigation partner for Kirkland & Ellis and clerk for both Judge Ralph Winter on the U.S. Court of Appeals in the Second Circuit and for Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas. She is co-founder of the Judicial Crisis Network and studied as a Publius Fellow of the Claremont Institute. Wendy, I would say to you, you are running for Senate, the Senate, I believe, is an enthusiastic Trump supporter. So I think it would be good to hear the flat-out case for Trump, not as he relates to conservatism, but why his policies are good for America. And you can also respond to any other comments that you've heard.
Sure.
Thanks.
Well, I think Charles has made this point. 2016, if it's nothing else, is the year of the outsider, of the non-politician. And we had several good candidates in the presidential race who were vying for that title. And you know, Ben Carson and Carly Fiorina, to some extent Ted Cruz. But Trump really, I think, was the most genuine expression of the real political outsider. He really had never been involved in politics. He was a businessman. And I think that this is a movement that has had roots growing for some time. You know, we hear about how much people hate Washington, but they keep electing the same people over and over again. It's tied to, you know, the emergence of the Tea Party. I think Trump is in some ways a second generation expression of the movement that began with the Tea Party. The Tea Party had a great start and a great initial success, but then I think you know, it really petered out and it didn't accomplish what some of us saw in its initial promise. But he's an outsider, and I think that the reason people are looking for an outsider is that the establishment has failed. It's failed both parties. And as Charles, I think, has mentioned, I can't recall if you mentioned it tonight, Charles, but perhaps on an earlier occasion, that both of the parties in America have sort of been hollowed out of any principle or meaning or real meaty intellectual or principled content. I think that's the reason why we see what's happening on the Democrat side, too, but we'll leave that to the side. But I think it's the same phenomenon on a different, template. What's happened with Republicans is that they've become just another power player. In other words, it's sort of like become the Yankees and the Mets, that these institutionalized establishment politicians stand really for perpetuating themselves for their own power. And of course, it's all about money, you know, follow the money. So I think that from the voters I see in New York and from what I've seen elsewhere, people are just so tired of representatives who don't have that spirit of self-sacrifice and public-spiritedness that the founders had, that was what gave birth to this country. And it was hammered home to me again today when I came to Washington. I looked around, and this town, since I was here, you know, during the Reagan years, has just been, it's been overgrown with lobbyists. And it's a huge company town, and it's a big business. It's no longer a principled federal city where representatives of the people come to debate great issues. And that's not what's happening in the Senate right now. The establishment is killing us. It's killing the people. And I think that that is what Trump has grabbed onto. I think that's his great attraction. And I think, yes, the problem is political correctness. And I think that Trump's solution to that is a conservative Republican instinct. And I think what I've seen of his constitutional instincts, they're very good. Yes, he hasn't studied in a think tank, and you know he hasn't been part of all the organizations that the people in this room have been part of. But when I see him responding to constitutional issues, what I see in his gut is a proper response. And that's the way he comes at this political correctness problem. Now, political correctness isn't just sort of an atmospheric term. Political correctness is killing our country. It's killing our national security, as we've seen what's happening. It's killing us militarily. It's killing our economy. We have not just the issue of trade, but the issue of cronyism and corporate welfare. We don't have free markets anymore in this country, and that's because of political correctness. It's an alliance of big government and big business, and their free markets are no longer operating. So when Trump responds to a policy issue, for example, he says he'd repeal and replace Obamacare. I think his solutions are, you know, worthy of Sally Pipes. They're good market-oriented solutions. I think that, you know, political correctness is also, as we know, killing our culture and killing our intellectual life. And as Charles has said, I think Trump not only cites that as a problem, he doesn't just point out that we're being politically correct. He himself is politically incorrect, and he's just charging at political correctness and throwing his body at it as a warrior. And we are in such bad shape. I mean, our country is over a cliff. And I think this republic isn't going to go on very long unless we have someone with the strength and the will and the force of a Trump to yank it back over the cliff. And I think from what I've seen of his principles and his policies, the content is there, although not fleshed out to the degree that most of the people in this room probably would wish. I think we can help him with that, and I think he'll be a good student.
Next respondent is Pete Wanger. He's a senior fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center and a contributing opinion writer to the New York Times. He served in the Reagan and George H.W. Bush administrations prior to becoming deputy director of speech writing for President George W. Bush. He is the author of City of Man, Religion and Politics in a New Era, and Wealth and Justice, the Morality of Democratic Capitalism. Well, Pete, you clearly represent another view. You have said you'll never vote for Trump. You can either explain why, or given that Bill referenced your article, you might want to respond to Bill, too. I mean, either way.
Sure. Please. Thank you. Thanks for having me. Thanks to the Claremont Institute and the Review of Books. Those are great institutions at a time when there are a lot of institutions that aren't doing their job. These are. So I'm I'm a huge fan of them and the people on this panel, many of whom I know, all of whom I've learned from. Let me take up a couple of the points, and then I'll make maybe my macro one. I heard Charles talk about this nominee of the Republican Party who's anti-PC going after it, and Bill, how he's calling out the Republican establishment in a kind of principled way for not being conservative enough, and Wendy talking about this man as a kind of principled outsider. And I think, God, I'd love to see this guy. And the interesting thing is, all of them, and they're very eloquent, they did a very nice job characterizing Donald Trump, but they didn't quote him. And I have a certain advantage because I can quote him. And the characterization that I hear up here about Donald Trump versus the reality is like night and day. This man began by talking about Mexican rapists and drug dealers, mocking John McCain about being a POW, mocking a reporter for his disability, referring to Ben Carson as pathological and a child molester, comparing him to that, attacking a U.S. district judge who is not Mexican as being a Mexican and being unable, intrinsically unable, to make a fair decision because of his ethnicity, who has shown a frightening obsession with Megyn Kelly, including what we look for in presidents, which are menstruation jokes, treating the military, threatening it, saying if you don't, that you will abide by my orders if I order you to do war crimes. He's incited violence among his own followers. He has talked in the creepiest way about his daughters. I don't know about you, but I think when fathers talk about their daughters and talk about how they're so good looking, he wishes he could date them several times from when they're infant to when they're older. That seems to me to be evidence of some kind of disorder. Libel laws against journalists that he'd like to pass against journalists who are critical of him. He's a man of staggering ignorance. Wendy talked about how he sounds like Sally Pipes. I've seen Donald Trump in debates. Have you seen him trying to answer a healthcare question? The best he can do is, we've got to get rid of lines across the states. It's an embarrassment. One of the worst moments for Donald Trump was when, during the debate, when Marco Rubio essentially ceded his time and said, let's hear about your healthcare plan. And he couldn't do it. He doesn't know the difference between the Quds force in Iran and the Kurds. He doesn't know what the nuclear triad is. He said he was going to eliminate the debt, $19 to $26 trillion, not in 10 years, but in 8. And he's going to do it, and get this, without reforming entitlement programs and pushing a tax plan that is going to increase the deficit by conservative estimates by $10 trillion. Here's also a man who is an astonishingly, even awe-inspiring liar. He is crude. He is cruel. I think he is temperamentally unprepared to be president. That's the main, if I had to say, my main opposition and my main concerns for Donald Trump. I think if he were president, it would be a threat to the Republic, because I think he is pathological, and I think that that's evidenced by having watched him for the last year. And I just think that he is temperamentally ill-equipped to be president. And I also think, and this is that he would redefine not just the Republican Party, but the conservative movement. I don't know where this idea that he has conservative principles. He has talked about opposing entitlement reform, and I want to get into what Bill said about Republicans not doing anything on entitlement reform. George W. Bush put his shoulder to the wheel for Social Security reform. We paid for it, did that. Paul Ryan got the entire Republican caucus for Medicare reform, a very difficult proposition. Trump is undoing that. He's praised Obamacare. He's talked about, praised the Obamacare mandates. He's talked about favorably about a single-payer health care system. He's in favor of a 45% tariff on China. He praised the Obama stimulus package when Obama was president. It wasn't that long ago. He's been a Democrat more of his life than a Republican. He's given a huge amount of money, including to Wendy's opponent, Chuck Schumer, which should disqualify him right there. You can take an example like abortion. This is a man who succeeded in his answer on abortion of offending the pro-life side by both saying he's in favor of Planned Parenthood and women who have abortion should be punished, should go to prison. Now, this kind of thing is being replayed over and over and over again. If he is, the fact that he's the nominee is problematic enough. If he is president, the Republican Party will not be the home of the conservative movement. You can kiss that goodbye. He has no interest in the conservative movement. He has no loyalty to the conservative movement. He's opposed conservatives and conservative ideas for much of his life. And I really do believe that if he were president of the United States, he would be an active danger to the Republic. Other than that, count me neutral.
Thank you all. That was great. I think there's clearly a range of opinions on this panel. I have some questions, but I think it might be more useful to just turn to panelists to respond. I mean, I think perhaps Pete's last challenge about Donald Trump's ignorance and his wrong policy proposals rather than other things, you know, maybe something someone would like to take on.
Can I just say one response to Pete? Some of the things I'm citing he may not have talked about in debates, but, you know, for example, his health care plans I read on his website, he's got them pretty fully fleshed out there. One other thing that he said that's interesting, and he calls this his immigration policy, and I've actually heard him say this. He speaks in a little bit of a different format than we're used to, but he says, you know, here are the three guiding ideas. You know, the first idea of his immigration policy is that a country without borders isn't a country. The next one is a country without laws isn't a country. And the third one is a country that doesn't take care of its own citizens first isn't a country. Now, those are three good policies, I think, not just for immigration reform, but as our friend and Hillsdale and Claremont scholar Tom West has said, those are principles that are worthy of many, many policies beyond just immigration. So that's the kind of thing. And then when we get to his judges, you know, we look at the prospective Supreme Court justices that he put forth. You know, no presidential candidate in history has ever done that before. So I think he was very forthcoming, and I think what we see with the judges he's named is a good indication of the seriousness and the conservative principles that would be behind his decision-making.
Great, fair points. Let me respond to them quickly. It'll take me literally, since it was directed at me, I just want to clarify. Because I think this makes an important point. She cites the website on healthcare, and that's the indication with Donald Trump that he's really a conservative, and immigration and judges. So let me take them in order. Donald Trump, in the course of roughly, I would say, 4 hours, changed his position on legal immigration three different times in a debate. He went into a debate against high-skilled workers, and that was the position of his website. During the debate, he said, "I've softened on it. I've changed my mind. I'm now in favor of having high-skilled workers come in." By the end of the debate, his campaign put out a statement and said, "Oh no, what he said in the debate, we're actually back to our original website." He doesn't know it's on his website. In terms of immigration, his immigration plan on the website was fine, except when he spoke about it, what did he talk about? The forced deportation of 11 million people, which he's gonna do, by the way, in 18 months. Good luck. He didn't know what was on his website about immigration. He threw that out in an interview with Chuck Todd. Or take judges, this list of judges, which is a fine list. I have no confidence that Donald Trump would either put his shoulder to the wheel to try and get them, or he could even name them or know them. This is a man who told us that judges, he likes judges who sign laws. Now, I'm sorry, this is like sixth grade civics. Now, if you've got a guy who's running for president that thinks judges sign laws, then excuse me for not being hugely moved by him releasing a name of 11 judges that some people came up with to try and pacify conservatives. He doesn't believe this stuff. He doesn't know it. And that's what matters. And when you become president, it's not your website that makes the difference. It's the man.
Well, that charge, the ignorance charge and the constantly change his mind charge are serious charges. Does anyone else? You want to respond to that, Martha, or no? You want to say something about something else? Okay.
I just want to say what a bunch of stupid idiots there are on this panel. I mean, these people are complete losers. I don't know what I'm doing up here with these people. They haven't a clue. I mean, you're all bored, right? I mean, tell me if you're bored. Raise your hand if you're bored, right? I mean, this is a complete garbage. This magazine you say you're putting out, does it make a profit? I mean, it's a rag. It's a complete rag. It's full of lies, disgusting lies. And, you know, I just don't know why any of you would bother to come to this. So You talk about a different format. I think in my amateurish way, I was just attempting to channel that format.
Let's hope that ratings go up.
Yeah, you know, the ratings are
free advertising.
The needles are going up. You know, I mean, the format, and I'm being polite and civil, you know, I could carry this a little further if you want me to. This question, we're all being too polite about this guy, you know.
I don't think I am.
I'm not criticizing you for being polite. But he's, you know, if he were a tribune of the people who was articulating the feelings that people have in this country about the migration of jobs overseas, you know, you all know the litany about illegal immigration, about the utter evasiveness of elites on these topics and other similar topics, not to mention the dead hand of political correctness, which it is a very stifling and dead hand, and it's increasingly everywhere and increasingly becoming a form of legal enforcement of speech. All those things are driving Americans crazy. If some bold guy got up who actually spoke, you know, the language of decent and respectable ordinary Americans and made these points, I would rush to his side. This guy is a creature of reality television. He spent 11 years of his life after his businesses proved to be something less than profitable or something less than you know, profitable to other people besides him. He went into reality TV and he became a trash TV celebrity. And that's what he is. And I think the political class needs to pay a little more attention to what that amounts to. What it amounts to, over time, his programs evolved into an assumption of absolute power by the host and deliberate humiliation and insult of everyone else and turning people against them. Just watch one of these shows sometime. They degenerated over time. And this is a kind of style which is characteristic of him. And I don't think it's going to change if he gains more power. I would like to know what article of traditional conservative understanding of philosophy, or even liberal political philosophy, says that people's characters improve when they get power.
Okay. Well, I have to say, Martha, that your channeling of him does remind me of one thing about Donald Trump. If he weren't, it's humor. If it wasn't actually funny and entertaining, I think people would read it differently. But Charles, do you want to respond to these, you know, you were about to listen before we cut you off Donald Trump's virtues. So maybe you want to respond to some of these attacks on his style and ignorance.
Well, there is a lot that is troubling about Trump. And Pete, I think, gives a nice catalog. And Martha alludes to many things as well. But I take it that Pete concedes that he's not a tyrant, or a would-be tyrant, or an aspiring tyrant.
I would concede that he's not Hitler, but I do think we can do better than that. I don't.
That's a low bar.
I'm not saying it's a high bar. I'm just saying. But then the question becomes: he does have many imperfections, and he's no, you know, he's just as he's no Hitler, he's no George Washington, or Abraham Lincoln either. But the question. Once you rule out, I think, the possibility that he is in fact a usurper and someone who intends to overturn constitutional government, then I think you're in a comparative mode from that point. And the question becomes, with all his imperfections, is it better to elect him as president as opposed to Hillary Clinton as president, who also has many imperfections. And that's the tough choice that we face. Now, I do think, however, that in a full accounting of Trump, you have to say something about his virtues, and so I will, instructed, say something very quickly. I apologize because this is just a list, really. He is, he is pro-America. Now, that sounds odd, but that is, it's not that Mrs. Clinton is anti-American. She's pro-American in a different sense. She loves and is loyal to the America that should be, the America that will result perhaps in the future when political correctness has been carried to its logical extreme. The America that is the America that is as it is today and was, she, like most liberals, liberal politicians, regards as a long, you know, that's a tale, that's a long litany of crime and oppression to be redeemed by a future of atonement, essentially. And maybe redemption at the end, but certainly at the end of history, but certainly not anytime soon. And I think millions of Americans recognize that in Trump, that he is, for all of its sins and foibles, he's for America. And they get that. And they may not be so sure about Mrs. Trump. Second, he does, I think, open a real possibility of the Republican Party and its intellectuals reconnecting to the working class or to the striving working class and middle class. And that would be good for both the Republican Party and the middle class and the working class. And third, is his singular opposition to political incorrectness. I mean, I think liberalism is really now defined by political incorrectness in a way it hasn't quite been before. It's a new stage, an ugly stage of public liberalism. They have gotten used to running the universities, and I think they increasingly want to run the country the way they run the universities, by doling out rights on the basis of sex, gender, you know, political opinions, ethnicity, class, and so forth, and deciding who gets freedom of speech and who doesn't get freedom of speech. And conspicuously, Trump is against that. That's not enough, I would say. I mean, he has a big mouth, as he would admit. But you know, being willing to be rude to people is not really the same thing as standing up for freedom of speech. And so it should be better. I mean, it should be more principled, it should be thought through, all of that I admit. But still, there is something about his willingness to take criticism and to keep fighting that is impressive. But that's not to say, again, that many of the things, everything that Pete says, or virtually, is true, or has an element of truth and therefore of concern about Trump. But what's the alternative?
Yeah, I just want to very quickly, because I'm going to disagree with him, I do want to emphasize how much I admire Charles Kessler, but, and here comes the but. let me just take each of those issues, those propositions that he set forward. He said that Donald Trump is pro-American. He has a pro-American slogan, that's all. I think that he, in many ways, is the antithesis of America. He certainly thinks in terms of ethnicity, and he actually embodies many of the worst tendencies of the left. And this is a man who, after all, was a active and a strong supporter of liberalism and the Democratic Party for most of his life, and was praising Hillary Clinton, the person that you've been so critical of, just a few years ago. And beyond that, this idea he's pro-American, this is the only man in my memory that I can think of that actively slandered the United States. And I will tell you when he did it. When he was what? He was praising Vladimir Putin. Vladimir Putin had praised Trump. Trump lavished praise on Mr. Putin. And when he was called on it, and he was told that Mr. Putin is a dictator and a murderer and that people had died, he said, because of the aggressions that Putin has engaged in, he said, well, America has done the same thing too. He did the moral equivalence. And I'm old enough to remember when conservatives used to be bothered by a moral equivalence between the Soviet Union and the United States. And this idea that he would drag America down and slander America in order to protect Vladimir Putin, I think destroys the idea that he's pro-American. In terms of reconnecting with the working class, what policies has he put forward to reconnect with the working class? What he's done is he's embodied a certain kind of resentment. But the idea that he has an active agenda to win over working class Americans is I think preposterous. He cannot articulate it. And I hear this all the time, which is Trump is anti-PC. Look, I'm as bothered by PC as anybody, and I've written about it over the years. But this is a confusion. Trump isn't just anti-PC. He's crude and he's cruel, and he crosses lines all of the time. And somehow his defenders keep saying, well, he's just anti-political correctness. No. When you attack a judge for his ethnicity and say that it is inherently impossible for a person with Mexican parents to make a fair ruling, or that Muslims inherently can't do it, that's not anti-political correctness. That's just wrong. And when you compare your opponent to a child molester, that's not political, being anti-political correctness. That's just wrong. And when you mock a POW for his service as being a POW, that's not anti-political correctness. That's just wrong. And when you get up and you mock a reporter with his physical disabilities and think that's funny, it's the kind of thing that you wouldn't allow in a first grade class. That's not political correctness. That's just wrong. And when you obsessively attack a woman and attack her because she is a woman, that's not anti-political correctness. That's just wrong. And the list goes on and on and on. And yet somehow that doesn't matter to a lot of people. And they say, well, he's anti-political correctness, and we as conservatives have to rally around that. If that is what it means to be a conservative in this age and in this era, then get off that train, because that is not any kind of conservatism that I want to be a part of, and I'm pretty sure it's not any kind of conservatism you want to be a part of. But if you're on that Trump train, that's where it's going.
Yeah, I think, Pete, some of these things I heard you say the first time around, you've repeated them again. I think that I'm not going to go example by example, though I'd be happy to.
How about if you answer them?
Well, that's what I'm going to answer a few, and I was about to say I'd be happy to, if the audience would indulge us, go point by point, and I'll give you my response. I jotted down a few. The one about the Mexican judge, and I say Mexican in the same way that I say I'm Swedish. He was only referring to his ancestry. I don't think he was claiming that he was a Mexican citizen, but that's beside the point. The real point is the impartiality point that you've raised. And as I understand it, what happened in the case was that this judge sort of inexplicably ordered the disclosure of some documents that were very harmful to his side in the case. This is a private litigation. So Trump was trying to figure out what in the world, and his lawyers were trying to figure out, what in the world could have caused the judge to make this ruling that on the facts and on the law, they couldn't explain any other way. And as you know, there is a doctrine in our jurisprudence about judges being impartial, about avoiding even the appearance of impartiality. And so a private litigant is well within his rights to say, what is it possible that this person is not being impartial as a judge should be? And I think Trump and his lawyers surmised that it might be Trump's positions on immigration, on deportation, on things like that, that could, because this judge was a member of an organization called La Raza. Now, I know there are different chapters of La Raza and different incarnations of La Raza, but the point is, he was affiliated with a lawyers group of La Raza that had participated in giving scholarships to illegal immigrants. And I think that clearly, there is a difference in political philosophy, and because Trump is so far out there on a different political philosophy, particularly about immigration, I think it was a legitimate question to raise whether the judge was impartial and indeed could have the appearance of impartiality. I don't think he was attacking his ethnicity. I don't think Trump is attacking anyone's ethnicity. I actually believe he's very American in the sense that he believes all races, creeds, colors should receive equal treatment under the law. But I think it was a legitimate question in that case about the ability of that judge to be impartial. I think what he does is he speaks in the vernacular and he speaks loosely. And if that's the criticism, I think that's well taken, because I think when you're running for president, you have to be a little more precise. So I think he said, oh, it's because he's Mexican. Well, that was speaking very loosely. I think he meant the whole thing about La Raza that I've just been saying. That's a long, this is why I don't want to go point by point, but I could on each one of these things. Some of them I think have been misinterpreted. The reporter and the disabled reporter, I think that was just flat out mischaracterized. I think he was criticizing something else about the reporter, which was he was flip-flopping and changing his positions, or
I can't remember what it was, but I don't think he was in any way mocking his disability. I think that's actually been mischaracterized. Yeah.
Just it'll take me 30 seconds. I just want to say Wendy's case was actually quite articulate, and if Trump had said it, I wouldn't have had nearly the problem. The problem is that if you read what Trump said, it's a matter of public record. He said that it's inherently incapable because he was a Mexican. He did actually go after his ethnicity. In terms of the reporter, I would just say go to YouTube and look at it. Decide for yourself. This isn't a close call.
Okay, well, Bill, I see you nodding, and I did want to turn to you. And also, the other point that Pete brought up, that this is bad for the conservatives and bad for the GOP, you also take up in your essay. Do you want to address that or anything else that comes to mind?
Well, audible, yes, yes. Okay. Scarred by that experience. No. Let's stipulate, for the sake of the argument, that everything Martha and Pete have said about what a bad guy Trump is true. The fact remains that against a field of 16 contenders for the Republican nomination, a field that George Will, in a September 2015 column, called the most talented in the Republican Party since 1980 and possibly the most impressive since 1856. Trump beat all these guys. This suggests that, in a way, the more bad things you say about Trump, necessarily the more bad things you say about the state of the modern Republican Party and conservative movement. If a guy who is this big a jerk can triumph over the leading politicians from across a broad spectrum with lots of money and organization and name recognition, if the person who emerged from that field is this rude, crude, obnoxious, cruel, vicious person, what does it say about the defects of the existing Republican Party? It seems to me that, and I'm going to leave that as a rhetorical question. It's too big to get into. But I think that there is a sense that the crucial item on the conservative to-do list in 2016 is to live through and make sure that the Trump phenomenon is the Trump parenthesis, that he loses in November of 2016, and we head back as fast as we can to the way things were before. I think that would be a mistake. I think it is often the case in American political history that worthy causes have unworthy champions. Anti-communism and Joseph McCarthy would be at the top of that list. What Trumpism consists of is not easy to say. It needs to be fleshed out. An exegesis of the collected speeches and tweets of Donald Trump is not especially useful for those purposes. But I think that the voters who chose him against all these other highly qualified candidates were saying something, were moved by something, were responding to something. And I think a smart conservative movement needs to figure out what that is. I will let me submit what I think is one strand in the fabric on this question of political correctness. Younger people in the audience may not know this, but there was a time when recorded music you purchased was not downloaded, but bought on plastic discs in things called record stores. And in the 1970s, the comedian Richard Pryor had an album out. The photo on the cover showed him tied to a stake with men in black hoods and robes, setting fire to piles of wood around his feet. And the title of the album was it something I said? I think that for those who spend a lot of time on campus in particular know this, that the regime of political correctness is one that demands people, especially from of all people really, of constant walking on eggshells to a constant multifaceted exercise in self-editing. And I believe one reason people responded to the zealously, crazily unedited Mr. Trump is that they are utterly sick of this. And instead of nominating somebody who seemed only able to sort of push at the edge of the envelope a little bit from time to time, the Republican Party primary voters went with somebody who just tore the envelope to shreds.
I think they are utterly sick of it, Bill, and I think they are utterly sick of the Republican establishment that to them looks a lot like the Democrat establishment, and it's basically one big face of the Washington establishment. You know, when Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell give Barack Obama an even bigger budget than he asked for that contains funding for Planned Parenthood, and they just roll these omnibus bills along, they keep raising the debt ceiling, and they pass these bills that are, you know, Dodd-Frank is this high, thousands of pages, legislation that no American can ever read and no one can ever hold anyone accountable for, not to mention the endless, again, thousands of pages of regulations that are issued by the unconstitutional administrative state. I think people have really had it. They're very fed up and they don't see anyone in Washington on either side standing up to this out of control government that they think is crushing and they know is crushing their lives. And so I think they want somebody who's going to come in and be a bull in a china shop. And I think that, you know, the American people have had pretty good sense, and I think we need to trust their judgment about this.
Well, I think we have only time for another comment right before we start Q&A. Charles, as the editor-in-chief of the CRB, do you want to make a concluding comment before Q&A? I don't think it'll have to be concluding. Because people have lots of questions. Or Martha, do you want to cede that to Martha?
I cede my time. Okay. Massachusetts.
You're excessively civil, Tom. Well, I guess I have to speak into this. I would just like to ask, I used in the piece I wrote in the Claremont Review the metaphor of the vat of sewage sitting next to the vat of wine. And if you pour a cup of wine into the sewage, it's still sewage. And if you pour a cup of sewage into the wine, it becomes sewage. And I think that there's a style of speech here which is not just against political correctness, it's also against the massaged, overworked, overstudied, overmanaged speech of all political candidates, including Republicans. They've all gotten to the point where they don't sound like human beings. They sound like planned or programmed robots speaking. And there's a huge reaction to that. But I think the reaction is coming from a quarter in the culture which is extremely unfortunate. And that's, you know, this very corrosive, uncivil, indeed anti-civil kind of entertainment that we have. It's perhaps understandable, but the fact that Trump speaks that way and the fact that our media, because their only constraints are those of the bottom line, are playing it up. There's very little debate on the broadcast media of the kind that we're hearing now that ordinary people can hear. It's really become a very, very degraded place. And it's imitating the entertainment space as much as possible. Now, that's bad enough if you stop at our water's edge. But I would just like to mention what happens beyond the water's edge. Charles has pointed out accurately that Trump is not Hitler. But I would ask you, is Trump Berlusconi? Is Trump Yanukovych? The 21st century strongman, the 21st century authoritarian who presides over a hollowed out democracy very often, is usually somebody who's very entertaining. It's somebody who has mastered modern entertainment media, somebody who's a celebrity, who lives a celebrity lifestyle, and the one thing that does not exist in those media spaces is serious political reporting. Serious political reporting is a very fragile thing. It is not profitable. It has never been profitable. And I guess I'd make an argument that it has to be protected in some way by the state or by a very strong tradition, or it simply will not survive. It's the one thing you don't find in the Russian media. You can find lots of reality shows, lots of shouting talk shows, lots of screaming heads, lots of that, and the strong men presiding over the whole thing, but no critical political reporting. So I would just leave you with that point. I don't know how we go back from this. And I think it's a much bigger issue than Donald Trump.
I think your point about Putin and how his rise is fueled by reality television in Russia was a fascinating point. You can all read it in the Claremont Review book. So now I'm going to turn for questions, and I'd ask that people keep their questions short. Assuming there are any questions, I think we've dealt with this phenomenon, but just in case, someone's going to, there'll be people bringing microphones around. Way in the back.
Pete Wehner, if Trump were elected, what's the worst that could happen?
I don't know. I mean, that's an endless speculation. And nobody knows, right? That's the problem. It could be that I'm wrong, and Charles and Bill are right, and Wendy, and he could turn out to be sober and decent and far-sighted and prudential. And the country moves on. Maybe he will change his mind, and he will reform Medicare like Paul Ryan wants to. That's a possibility. I think it's highly unlikely. Or it could be that he is a person who is, in my estimation, is as erratic as president as he's been as a candidate, and as unprincipled as president as he's been as a candidate, and as narcissistic and enticed by power. How that works out is impossible to know. I do know this, having worked in three administrations, one president closely, and read a lot of history, I do believe that when you're making a choice for president, that idea of temperament, disposition, habits of heart and thought are probably the most important thing to look for. I wouldn't look for really what's on a website. I don't think that's necessarily unimportant, though with Trump I think it is unimportant because I don't think he knows what's on his website. But I think even for most candidates, it's not just the check the box quality. It is, does this person have the disposition and the prudential judgment to be the most powerful person in the world? But there are an endless amount of scenarios that you could come up with of things that could go wrong. Everything from a man who uses threats of power, being in control of the IRS and the FBI and the NSA and so forth, and the military, to a lot of bad things happening.
If I could just interject a quick comment. I think I know predictions cannot be proven, of course, but one thing you can look at is the current life and his behavior. He will spend a lot of time and energy going after his critics in all sorts of extremely unpleasant ways, I predict.
But he will also face the most critical press of any president since Ronald Reagan, I would say, and maybe since Lyndon Johnson, in a way. The campuses will be erupting. He will have, and you know, in all likelihood, he will be alienated. He certainly will be alienated from the Democratic Party in the Congress, and probably from the Republican Party, too. So that's a formula for a very weak president. And that's not good. But I think that if one were to predict, I think that's more likely than that he will prove to be Putin-esque or something like that.
And at least he'll go after his opponents in a open and transparent, however aggressive way. I mean, it's one thing to do that, to be very belligerent in public. It's another thing to use the force and power of government secretly, whether through prosecutorial misconduct or through directing the agents of the IRS to go after and audit people with whom you disagree politically. I think it's better to have it up front and have loud, sometimes unpleasant arguments than to be secretly manipulating the levers of government behind the scenes against the political opponents, as we have now.
All right, let's do another over there.
My name is Bishop Davidson. I'm a student at Mizzou, so I'm familiar with PC culture. But also, as a first-time presidential voter, this is my first time in a presidential election. I'm really trying to weigh this seriously. I had a question, I guess it's an open question, regarding kind of the conservative bloc, and is this an opportunity for the conservatives to make a break from the Republican Party and establish ourselves in any sort of form of having a philosophical underpinning that kind of supersedes, I guess, politics?
I think that might be a question for you, Pete, right? What do you think of that?
No, at this point, I don't think so. I think that the Republican Party is the natural political home for conservatism. I do believe that if Mr. Trump becomes president, and I don't think he will, I would be shocked if he would. Of course, I didn't think he'd be the nominee either, so that has to be said as well. Then I think he would have to, in my estimation, principled conservatives would have to think about a breaking part of it, because I certainly wouldn't want to be a part of the conservative movement or Republican Party where Mr. Trump were the nominee and the head of it. But my suspicion is that, or the way I'm viewing this, I guess, is we're in a kind of triage moment between now and November to try and salvage whatever we can, and it won't be easy since he's the nominee. I do think he'll lose in November, and I suspect after that there will be a very spirited and vigorous debate about the future of the party and of conservatism. And I agree with Bill. I don't think that the Republican Party should go back to what it was. And I do think that there are problems with the Republican Party, and there's no question Mr. Trump tapped into it. My problem isn't that, or my objection isn't that there aren't problems that the Republican Party has had, though we'd have to talk about those specifically. But as a general matter, I'm fine with that. It's the idea that Mr. Trump is the vehicle to correct those things. So if you're a frustrated conservative, you think that the Republican Party hasn't been conservative enough, I'm fine. But the idea that Donald Trump is the person who's going to advocate the kind of conservatism that people want, I just think is fantastic.
Okay, how about, do you have a question, Matt?
Question.
Okay. Yeah.
Please answer, but
Charles. If the way we look at politics is through institutions, and you've had in the past questionable presidents, poor presidents, 19th century presidents we wouldn't want to have, would you add checks and balances, other things to keep an eye on? What are the things that you would look at, ask this to everyone, two or three things? Vice President is the cabinet, stronger Congress, what things would put you in a position of accepting, perhaps not embracing, but accepting someone like Trump?
Wait a minute, is that for me? Well, you know, one of the one possible outcome of a Trump presidency would be a glorious reconciliation of the Democratic and Republican parties. In a rediscovery of the impeachment clause constitution and a newfound dedication to constitutional principle and literalism, including separation of powers. That's a possibility, actually. I mean, it's something you'd have to think about. That would be, in a way, a very healthy development. I think what Paul Ryan should be saying now is not, developing your own policy agenda is fine as far as that goes, but it doesn't really work. You can't run American government from the speakership of the House, as Newt Gingrich tried to do and failed to do. But he could be saying that he looks forward to the Trump presidency, confident that the Congress will exercise all of its constitutional prerogatives and powers, and that he thinks that both parties will join together to keep the Constitution safe throughout the presidency, whatever the policies will be. That, it seems to me, is the proper position, and the difference between, an America with Trump as the president and Argentina, or some other country with strong presidencies that sometimes devolve into dictators. The difference is the Constitution.
Okay. Bob Riley over here.
Yes. I think the most upsetting thing about Trump's remark on the judge was not an attack on ethnicity, but it seemed to reveal an inability on his part to distinguish between the public good and his private good. He's making this critique as a presidential candidate to protect his private good, and it seems his career in the art of the deal has been to exploit the public good for his private good in gaming the government and the legal system and so forth. So Charles, that would seem to indicate to me that he may be pro-Trump and not so much pro-America.
Right, which would be an ingredient of the tyrant. If that were true, I think that would be a serious thing. Trump's criticism of the judge was that he was putting, in his own strange way, Trump was saying he's putting his private good above the public good, above the public duty that he has to follow the law and rule fairly in this case. It happens to be a private case, however, that's true. But in a strange way, it was still, I think, an attempt to vindicate the judicial function and thus the public good.
And also, Trump isn't the one who brought this whole case of Trump University into the presidential campaign. It's his critics and mainly the media who raised this, element of his private life, his prior business life. It's an active litigation, but he is not the one who injected it into the campaign. Having had it injected, I think he needed to respond. He couldn't just not respond to the accusations that were being made.
Okay, let's take this young lady in the middle here.
It might be useful if you gave your name or your something.
Sure. Hi, I'm Martha. I'm also Martha. I know Martha, so I'm Martha.
all Marthas know each other.
Exactly. cabal of Marthas. So I actually had three, and I'll keep it really short, three questions to three people. So my first question for Charles was about the way you set up your argument between these two visions of Trump. One is the buffoon and one is the tyrant, and you said that they were there was a tension between them. I didn't understand why there was a tension between them, because to me it seems like there would be more of a synergy between them, especially, I think of phrases like the banality of evil, and how easy it is for a buffoon to take steps towards illiberal policies unthinkingly. And then for Bill, I guess my question was more about your refuting these conservative principles that are laid out, that Pete Wehner's principles of the conservative movement, that because Republicans in practice haven't achieved these big ideas, that somehow refutes the ideas themselves, that then we should throw away these ideas because we haven't been able to accomplish these goals in practice, even though they aren't goals, these are ideas. So I just didn't see how these two points you made really refuted one another. And then my final question was for, on the panel, running for Senate. You talked about the Tea Party movement failing, or somehow that the Tea Party movement didn't accomplish its goals. I mean, to what extent do you think that the Trump movement is going to be any more successful at accomplishing what it's setting out to do?
I think we better limit this to one question.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Way too much. And we have only time for one question to ask you two. So how about, who volunteers of the ones directed at them to take up this lady's question? Is there anyone inspired? Okay, thank you, Charles.
Well, strictly speaking, the two arguments that I identified are not contradictory. I mean, it's possible that they could overlap, which is why I said they were in tension, but not in contradiction. But they are in tension, it seems to me, because the notion that he has no agenda. He can be, for national health care one minute, he can be against it the next minute. But what he's most concerned about is performing and being in the limelight, hogging all of the attention. Is a very different one from one that says he wants, to subvert constitutional government. Now, why would I raise such an extreme case? Because that case has been made against him. I mean, that's what Robert Kagan said in the Washington Post. That's what David Frum essentially has suggested at the Atlantic. It's what Andrew Sullivan said quite explicitly at great length in wherever it is now,
New York,
in New York magazine. So I know it's I acknowledge it's not a great forensic achievement to have proved that Donald Trump is not Hitler. But nonetheless, that is an argument, and a very, very serious argument that has been made against him. And if we're going to understand him, I think, as he sort of understands himself, you know, difficult as that might be, I don't think that is really what he's thinking about or aiming at. And the problems with him are different from that.
I would just quickly say that Hitler was a mesmerizing communicator. And he did dominate the media through different means. And so he had a big, big, big megaphone. And he was very good at touching the nerve, along with his friend Joseph Goebbels, touching the nerve of the painful nerves of the public. There are some similarities there, but certainly otherwise, no.
Bill, you want to take a comment as well?
Martha. Just briefly to try to speak to your question. My point was that it would be one thing if the conservative movement and the Republican Party had set high, distant goals and was moving towards them slowly. I think it would then be fine for sort of the Republican establishment to say, look, we're engaged in a big project here. Rome wasn't sacked in a day. This is going to take time. But I think the thing that Trump tied into was the feeling that there's a double game going on, that the Republican establishment speaks the language of governance and practicality and realism inside the Beltway and speaks the language of resistance and revolution outside. And these orthodoxies that are supposed to be the constitutive elements of the conservative movement, given the resonance of the Trump message, strongly suggest that people are catching on to the fact that these are kind of stale orthodoxies to which we give ritual lip service, that they don't describe in any serious way what the Republican Party within a cab ride of this building is actually up to. If the low-hanging fruit are always higher than any Republican ladder, then there is something more than just the difficulty of the enterprise that is wrong with what conservatism is up to.
Well, I think I'm now told that the bar closes at 8:30. So it's already 8:05. So I know there are a lot of other questions, and I think the panelists will be availing themselves of the bar and will be around for questions as well. And I think this has been a very lively discussion, and I think it does fulfill our purpose of raising the level of debate on this important subject. I would like to thank our five great speakers. I would like to thank the Kirby Center for co-hosting it with us, and thank you all for coming.